And sure enough, on Father's Day of all days, we've been praying for revival for 2.5 years, but you'd think revival would break out maybe on July the 4th, not Father's Day, you know what I'm saying? And so I almost didn't go to church that morning because my mother had just passed away and she'd only been dead 5 weeks, and I was still grieving about that. And I had a prophet call me and tell me that during the time my mother was dying, he said, "Brother John," he said, "I don't know what this means," and he didn't even know. He just said, "What you've been praying for will come when your mother's gone." And sure enough, she passed away 5 weeks, and revival broke out on Father's Day. It was a major experience. I'll never forget it as long as I live. I never dreamed that you could feel the presence of God that strong and get up and walk away. It wasn't scary. It wasn't phobic. It was absolutely the most amazing experience that a person could have. But the thing that really touched me about the Brownsville Revival was the souls. It was the souls. I'm going to tell you a story real quick before I preach. It was amazing how the Lord said, "If I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me." And how the Lord began to draw sinners to that church. The lines began to form in the morning, like at 5 o'clock in the morning. And the doors didn't open until 6 o'clock at night. People would go through thunderstorms and wouldn't lose their place in line. They'd go through lightning and thunder, and it can lightning and thunder in Alabama, in Florida. So they would start gathering about 5 o'clock in the morning, and then when we'd open the doors, one time we had a little camera in the ceiling like that, and we counted when we opened up all the doors and let everybody in at 6 o'clock. They'd been there all day long. It took less than 1 minute to fill up a sanctuary that seats 2,500 people. Wow. It took less than 1 minute. They were coming in from all directions. But the sinners is what really amazed me, how the sinners begin to come. You know, it's one thing to have a refreshing and a renewal, but when sinners start coming, I'm talking about sinners. There was a lady came from the Dallas Morning News, and she met with me and Steve one night before service. She wanted to meet with us and get more of the story. The revival hadn't been going on very long. And she said, "Which one of you is the pastor?" And I said, "I am." She said, "Pastor, did you know there's people out there in that line smoking marijuana?" I said, "Praise God." She said, "You can't be serious." I said, "Yeah." I said, "That's great." She said, "Pastor, you can't be serious." I said, "Yeah." I said, "How many other churches do you know of where people's lining up to get in the house of God like people lines up to get in Best Buy on Black Friday? You know what I'm saying? How many people do you know that's lining up to get in the house of God, especially sinners?" And she said, "Pastor," she said, "there's people out there sunbathing in two-piece bikinis." I said, "Hallelujah, glory to God." She said, "Well, I'm telling you," she said, I came up to this guy," and she said, he had on skivvies, some kind of skivvies. And she said, "He just had on like a pair of underwear type stuff." She said, "He had tattoos over his whole body. Even his eyelids had OK on it." And she said, "There wasn't a square inch of his body, I don't guess, that didn't have tattoos on it." She said, "He looked like a snake." And she said, "I walked up to him and I said, 'Hi, I'm from the Dallas Morning News. What are you doing here?' He said, 'I don't know.'" And she said, "Well," she said, "surely you know what you're doing here." He said, "Lady, I don't know what I'm doing here." She said, "Well, where do you go to church?" He said, "Lady, I've never been to church a day in my life." She said, "Well, where are you from?" He said, "Wisconsin." She said, "Well, how did you wind up down here at this major revival in Pensacola, Florida?" He said, "Lady," he said, "I was one day riding my Harley in Wisconsin and I heard a voice that said, 'I'll meet you in Pensacola at the revival.'" So there he was. And that night, whenever Steve preached and gave the altar call, old Snake was the first one to dive in the altar like a third baseman diving into home plate. I mean, he just dove right in and gave his heart to the Lord. I remember, you see all kinds of things, you know, you smell marijuana in the church, you smell cigarettes and people standing out in the foyer even smoking, all kind of stuff, you know, just sinners coming, just being drawn. And I remember we had, that's good, and to go and give God praise, it's okay. I remember we hadn't had a hurricane in Pensacola in a long time, and we had two hit when revival broke out in June. We had one in August and one in September, two of them. They just come in like that and just tore the place up. So these two Playboy bunnies had come in from Chicago to do a shoot on the beach. Two Playboy bunnies, and they were staying at a hotel out there in East Pensacola. So they called a cab, and they wanted to go out and enjoy the night. So they asked the cab driver, they said, "What's the happening place?" In Pensacola. And power was out everywhere in Pensacola except in Brownsville. Hey. The Brownsville community. Out everywhere, and it was still going. And he said, "I know just the place to take you." So he brought them to Brownsville. They got out and come in, and I'm telling you what, man, they were decked out, buddy. They had no idea when they left that hotel they was going to church. When the cab driver let them out, he's like, what? And so they came on in. They had on their spiked heels, you know, and they were dressed fit to kill. They were beautiful and they were sexy. So they came into church, and when they came in, you know, the usher seated them. And it was, revival hadn't been going on too long, so I was sitting on the platform, and I was just sitting there thinking to myself, reckon what Brownsville thinks of all these sinners being in here. You smell marijuana in the church, and sitting by people that stinks. I said, reckon what my holy roller people thinks about this. So I looked up, and I looked in the back, and I see them two Playboy bunnies coming in. And I said, "Oh, Jesus, I'm fixing to find out." So there they were. And the place was slammed full, but there were two seats right there. And I said to myself, "God, if you've ever helped me, help me now. Don't let them ushers see them two seats right there." And by that time, I saw the usher say, "Oh, right this way." And they came down the aisle in their spiked heels, you know, and they had on like halter tops. They were bouncing and jiggling all the way down the aisle. And so they put them in there, and I said to myself, "Jesus, help me. Help me, Holy Spirit." So that night, Spirit of the Lord moved in during worship. It was awesome, just awesome presence there. And then about that time, Steve was preaching, you know, and he gave the altar call, preached to sinners and gave the altar call. Those two girls dove. They dove like they were diving in water. Dove from those two seats right there to the altar, face first. And I looked, and I saw my WMs. That's women's missionary ministries. The ones that has the Pentecostal buns in the back. I saw four of them, six of them. I saw six of them get up, and I saw them look right toward the platform, right toward me. And here they came, like this. And I thought, "Jesus, give me wisdom." They come, went right behind my chair, got six prayer cloths, and they handed them out. And those women, one stood here, 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 and one stood here. And they built a little sanctuary for those women to pray. Because when they dove in the altar, there wasn't much left to the imagination. But they were crying their eyes out and getting saved by the power of God. And here's what I saw. Here's what I saw. I saw these women standing there, and they stretched out these prayer cloths, and they built a little tabernacle for those women to pray through to an old-fashioned salvation. When I looked at their faces as they were holding those rags, those prayer cloths, I saw tears streaming down their faces, and I could see the TV lights reflecting in their tears. And I said to myself these words, Lord, you finally found you a place, haven't you, where you can do what you want to do, when you want to do it, and how you want to do it. Isn't that awesome? Is that the way it is here at Fresh Start Church? God, do what you want to do, when you want to do it, and how you want to do it. Come on, give him praise. Woo! Woo! My God, praise him. Everybody stand up here for a minute. Lift your voice. Shapa. Something here this morning. Come on, give him praise. It's okay. Woo! Hey! Mighty God. Mighty God. Woo! Wow, you may be seated. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles this morning. If you will stand one more time, and just, I'll always like to have the congregation stand when I read my text. I like to stand in honor of the reading of the word. It's in 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 3. It'll be on the screen for those of you that don't have your Bibles, or those of you that don't yet have a Bible. And it's just a powerful verse of scripture. It's very brief. It says, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, and the God of all comfort. Would you please say that out loud with me, please? The Father of all mercies. Say it one more time. The Father of all mercies. I want you to look at Psalms 136. If you'd like to turn in your Bibles with me, you can, but it'll also be on the screen. Psalms 136, this is a very powerful, powerful scripture. Just want to glance at every verse in Psalms 136 ends up with his mercy endures forever. It said, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, his mercy endures forever. Oh, give thanks to the God of gods, his mercy. Oh, give thanks to the Lord of lords, his mercy. To him alone that does great wonders, to him that by wisdom made the heavens, to him that stretched out the earth above the waters, to him that made great lights, the sun to rule by day, the moon and stars to rule by night, to him that smote Egypt and their firstborn, brought out Israel from among them, and it goes on and on and on. Every verse ends with his mercy endures forever. Would you please say that out loud with me like you really mean it? His mercy forever. You may be seated. Thank you. I think for many years we've been trying to figure God out. I think for many years people have tried to go in the scriptures and find that one thing that pretty well sums God up. I think about the Lord all the time. I know you think about the Lord all the time. He's always on my mind. My mind is always on the Word. I've been preaching for 50 years. And the way I've trained myself through the years is I think all day long and I'm gathering ideas for sermons. And I think about Him all the time. But I've never been able to quite sum Him up in one particular word. I know he's powerful. I know he's full of grace. I know that he's the creator. I know that he's loving and he's kind. But I think in my studies, I think that I have finally come up on something that pretty well sums him up better than anything else that I can even tell you, and that is the word mercy. That's what I'm preaching on this morning, as I'm speaking on the subject of mercy. I heard that our speaker last night preached on mercy. Yes. And I heard it was good too. Yes. Amen. God bless him. I saw Dutch Sheets at the inauguration up in Washington, and we've been friends for a long time, and he preached on mercy up there, and I told him after he got through preaching, I said, Dutch, man, I'm preaching on mercy right now. He said, John, my message is much better than yours. I said, I don't know, but the only thing I know is lately the Lord's been giving me revelation on mercy, and I'm glad to see how wonderfully that he's revealing that to other people. People's been trying to figure God out, and the reason we can't is because we've never really quite understood the subject of mercy. Webster says, mercy is a blessing that is an act of divine favor and compassion, or compassion. Webster says that mercy is compassionate treatment for those in distress, forbearance of punishment even when justice demands it, extending help even to the lowliest and the most undeserving. Mercy is goodwill. It's a willingness to grant favors and an extended hand to the undeserving. I have had a powerful insight in the last few months about the mercy of God. Never really preached on it that much down through the years, but I believe I've had a revelation on it as far as myself personally is concerned, and that's usually where I preach the best, is what God reveals to me. One of the things I've learned is that mercy opens the door to all of God's treasures. Mercy opens the doors. Now you might say, Brother Kilpatrick, no, you're wrong. Faith opens the door to all of God's greatness. Well, faith is very important too. Very important. But I'm going to tell you in a minute why I'm preaching on mercy. Israel, I found out, was in great danger, and I went back in my Bible and I began to look through the passages of scriptures about God's mercy, and I was surprised at what I found. To be honest with you, I was shocked. I began to go through the Old Testament and I saw it continuously. I went in the New Testament and I was shocked to see it in the New Testament. There's many things that we go in the Old Testament and we see, and it's really good and it's revealing. But when you graduate over the New Testament, you don't see a lot about it. Mercy is one of the only things that you find in the Old Testament that you also find exactly the same or even greater in the New Testament. So the Bible says that Israel was in great danger. They were overwhelmed by hostile forces. Jehoshaphat was leading God's people. They were greatly outnumbered and they were outarmed. Then after a time of fasting and prayer, God gave Jehoshaphat some insight, and I want you to look and see what it says. The Lord said to him, "Hearken, ye all Judah, all ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat. Thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow, go down against them. Behold, they come up by the cliff of Ziz, and you shall find them at the end of the brook, before the wilderness of Jerul. You shall not need to fight in this battle. Set yourselves, stand still, see the salvation of the Lord with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, the Lord will be with you." So the next day, it was day of battle. And when they went out, Jehoshaphat got all the praisers together. He had the army there also, but he had the praisers there. And facing their greatest enemy, facing an enemy that was overwhelming, and they were underarmed and outnumbered, they didn't send their best troops, but they sent the singers. And it's amazing to me what I saw. I've read this so many times, and I never saw this until recently. It said, when he had consulted with the people, Jehoshaphat, he appointed singers unto the Lord, that they should praise the Lord in the beauty of his holiness. And as they went out before the army, they were to sing only one phrase. They were not to sing a song with verses and a chorus. They were to chant this phrase over and over. They did not need to carry a tune. They did not need to have great tenor voices, bass voices, soprano voices, whatever, you know. When they went out, they were to sing one thing and sing one thing only, And he said, say, praise the Lord. His mercy endures forever. Can't you imagine being an army and you've got the enemy overwhelmed and you've got them outnumbered? They don't have a dog's chance. And you look up and you see this ragtag army coming out with a bunch of singers, and all they're singing is, praise the Lord, his mercy endures forever. I don't know if you know it or not, but that's where the first rap song came from, right there. Praise the Lord, his mercy endures forever. What they were actually singing was, you better back off. God's with us in a mighty way. Don't fool with us. If you know what's good for you, back off. Come on, give God praise. Woo! Can we say it right now? Praise the Lord. His mercy endureth forever. Woo! Man. Ho! When God directs his army and tells them what to sing, he said, just sing of my mercy. I don't know what the army heard, but they got their hinds whipped in a hurry. God's mercy will put your enemies to flight. I want to say that again for somebody else. Let me say it again. God's mercy will put your enemies to flight. God's mercy will put the IRS to flight. God's mercy will confuse the lawyers and the prosecutors that's coming against you. God's mercy will open up the heavens and cause what's yours to come to you. Come on, give God praise. Oh! Woo. Mercy! Now I want to show you something that I learned. I'm going to go back. I'm going to flip back and forth a good bit from the Old Testament to the New Testament. Now, everybody knows this verse of Scripture right here. This is a New Testament verse of Scripture. It's found in Mark. And the Bible said they came to Jericho. And as Jesus went out of Jericho with the disciples, a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out, Jesus! Thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace. In other words, be quiet. But he cried the more a great deal, Thou son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. They called the blind man and they said unto him, Be of good comfort, rise, he's calling for you. And he, casting away his garment, rose, and he came to Jesus, and Jesus answered and said unto him, What do you want me to do for you, son? The blind man said, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, Go thy way, thy faith has made thee whole. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus on the way. And I want to just stop right here for a minute, because I'm not going to pause here for a moment, because everybody knows this passage of Scripture, but I want to show you something that I don't know if you caught or not. This man, when Jesus was passing by, he only said one thing. Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And he kept crying that same phrase. Have mercy on me, Lord. And they said, Shh, he's coming. He's calling for you. And he went up there and Jesus said, What can I do for you? He said, That I might receive my sight. And here's what Jesus said. He said, Go thy way. Your faith. He asked for mercy. But Jesus said, Your faith has made you whole. Can I tell you something? You're not going to ask for mercy unless you have faith in the first place. Now, I want you to bite into that, because I'm going somewhere with that. He said, Your faith has made you whole. Go in peace. This man didn't say anything about, Lord, I'm blind. I've got great faith. Oh, boy, when you and I get together, I'm going to get my miracle. That's not what he said. Lord, have mercy on me. And Jesus healed him, and he said, Son, your faith made you whole. Now, I want to show you something else. That was a blind man. I want to show you two other sets of blind men. In Matthew chapter 9, this is not a blind man, this is two blind men. When Jesus departed, two blind men followed him crying, "Thou son of David, have mercy on us." Isn't it interesting? I'm not going to read the rest of it, but let me take you over into Matthew chapter, go to the next one, chapter 20. Two more sets of blind men. They were sitting by the wayside, and when they heard that Jesus passed by, they cried out, "Have mercy on us, Lord, thou son of David." And the multitude rebuked them because they should hold their peace, but they cried the more, saying, "Have mercy on us, Lord, thou son of David." So we got five blind men right now, two sets of blind men in the same chapter. The last set of blind men was in Matthew 9. Look back in Matthew chapter 9. "Thou son of David, have mercy on us." But now we're in Matthew chapter 20, so it's not a repeat. These are two more blind men. And they're crying the same thing that Bartimaeus cried. Now when I saw that, it opened up my mind that I began to think about, okay, now wait a minute. What's going on here? Blind men, have mercy on me. Two blind men, a set of blind, have mercy on us. And then over in chapter 20, another set of blind guys, have mercy on us, thou son of David. So five guys got their healing by asking for mercy. Now let me show you something else that's interesting. When I saw that, I began to go back and I began to just sort of peel through the New Testament. And it said that Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And there was a woman of Canaan came out of the coast and cried unto him, "Have mercy on me, Lord, thou son of David." Look at that. "My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil." He answered her not a word. His disciples came and besought him, saying, "Send her away. She cries after us." He answered and said, "I'm not sent unto the lost, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Then came she and worshipped him and said, "Lord, help me." He answered and said, "It's not meet to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs." And she said, "True, Lord. Yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from the master's table." Jesus answered and said unto her, "Great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as you will." And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. Now let's look at this one more time here. We're just getting into this. Let's look at something. These people in the New Testament evidently had interpreted the prophets, and the prophets told things about the Messiah when he was going to come. You know that many in the house of Israel never believed on Jesus, but many did. And when Jesus came, it was a time of visitation for Israel. Many didn't recognize that hour of visitation, but many did. And they realized that the son of David was going to be born in Bethlehem, and they knew the prophetic scriptures about him. So they began to understand that this Messiah, this Jesus, is going to be a man of great mercy. So far, everybody that got a miracle, and I want you to see this. So far, everybody that got a miracle that I've told you about cried out the same thing that the Lord told Jehoshaphat in the Old Testament to sing. "The Lord is great, and his mercy endures how long? Forever." Now in the New Testament, Bartimaeus, a set of blind men, another set of blind men. Now this woman, she's a Gentile. She hears about Jesus. And she says, "Jesus, have mercy." She says, "Jesus, have mercy on me, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed of a devil." So some got healing by asking for mercy. But here's a mother that got deliverance for her daughter from a demon spirit by asking for mercy. Now look at this father. This is interesting. When they were come to the multitude, there came unto him a certain man kneeling down to him, and he said, "Lord, have mercy on my son." Oh my goodness. It's all the way through the New Testament. Everywhere Jesus is going, people's crying out to him for mercy. Look what he said. "Lord, have mercy mercy on my son. He's a lunatic. He's vexed. Oftentimes, this spirit will take him and throw him into the fire and many times try to drown him in the water. And I brought him to your disciples and they couldn't cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him to me. And Jesus rebuked the devil and he departed out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. When the disciples came to Jesus and said, why could we not cast him out? Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief. Verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed. Now remember, this man didn't say, I've got great faith. This man appealed to the mercy of God. How many of you knows when you appeal to God's mercy, your mouth won't even ask for mercy unless you believe that he is and a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Can you shout amen?
Amen.
You know, let me just pause here for a minute before I go any further and tell you something that I've experienced in the ministry that's really turned me off. I've been pastoring since 1970. I took my first church when I was 20 years old, and I was right out of Bible school. It was right during the time of the charismatic movement, you know, it erupted shortly thereafter. And I have nothing but the greatest of respect for the charismatic movement. I had so many people integrated into our church from the charismatic movement. And I have nothing but the greatest respect for all the teachers on faith. I have all their books. I believe in them and I practice them. But in the house of God and in my ministry, I began to see through the years, even up until recently, that many people would believe God for something and they'd get an answer to their prayers and they'd sort of strut. They sort of strut, you know, like, I wish you had as much faith as I do. And somebody in the church has cancer, and they'll say, you know, I had cancer 16 years ago, but God healed me. I really laid hold of my faith, and I got a hold of God, and I got healed. And if you'll do the same, he'll heal you too. You know. And all that's fine. But I got to the point in my life that I saw such a pride and such an arrogance come on some people that really call themselves having great faith. And when they get an answer to their prayers, they would sort of get a little bit of a thing about them that they would begin to talk down to other people in the church that they didn't think had as much faith as they do. So I have an answer for that. It's mercy. I said it's mercy. Here not too long ago, I had a situation come up and I just got through preaching on mercy, and it was really a revelation to me. I've always understood God's mercy a little bit. I've always understood it and I believed in it. But I just got through preaching on mercy and all these scriptures that I'm going to give you, and I've got a lot more to give you. And I had a situation come up. It came up at exactly a strategic time for me, and it had to do with the state of Alabama. It had to do with the EPA. And I hit a situation to where I was going to have to spend a lot of money. And I had a situation to where I hit governmental agencies that was not going to bend whatsoever. It was a done deal. I had to come up with a bunch of money and I had to do a bunch of tearing out and ripping up. And I went before the Lord and I just got through preaching on mercy and I said, Lord, you know what I'm up against here. This is a governmental agency. And you know that this is a situation that in the natural, it's hopeless. And I said, God, I beseech you in Jesus' name, have mercy on me. I said, Lord, none of this was intentional. This is something that happened 20 years ago. Help me, Jesus. Could I tell you what happened? The Lord had mercy on me. And I never had to spend the first cent. God had mercy on me. Here's what I believe that God is saying to all of us. He's saying when you are facing situations that's too big for you, And many times you don't feel like your faith fits the situation. You don't feel like your faith is up to par to deal with that situation. The Lord's saying, I've got an answer for you. Don't come at me with your great faith. All you need is the size of a grain of mustard seed. Come to me and appeal to my mercy, and I will show you mercy. May God show mercy on every one of us today and give us a breakthrough and answers to our prayer. Come on, give God praise. Hey! Let me hurry on. Luke chapter 17. It came to pass as they went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. As he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices, and look what they said. Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. They're a great way off. They called him Master. Now, he hadn't died on the cross yet. He hadn't shed his blood for their sins yet. He hadn't really fully been revealed, and the Holy Spirit hasn't been sent yet. These guys had leprosy, and the leprosy had probably eaten their fingers off. They were contagious, probably eating their toes off, maybe eating an ear off or part of their nose or part of their face. And they had to be far off because they couldn't mix and mingle with the public. They had a hopeless situation. And when Jesus came into Galilee and those 10 lepers saw him, they were all bandaged up, didn't want people to see them, didn't want people to see their wounds. They cried out. Where did they learn this? They learned it from the Old Testament. They said the Son of David is coming in the Old Testament. And when the Son of David comes, he'll rise and have healing in his wings. How? My God, I feel that. There's healing in the wings of the Lord. There's healing in the presence of the Lord. Don't try to impress God with your faith. Ask for mercy. And they said, Jesus, have mercy on us. Look what Jesus said. When he saw them, he said unto them, go show yourself unto the priest. It came to pass as they went, they were cleansed. But now listen, not only were they cleansed, but their nose grew back. Not only did their nose grow back, their fingers come back, fingernails and all. Their toes popped back out. Because when you're cleansed of leprosy, God restores what the leprosy took away. Oh, come on, somebody give God praise. I said, give God praise. He don't just have mercy. He restores. He renews. He revives. Oh, God, revive us again and restore, Lord, what the enemy has stolen from us. Give God praise. Come on, somebody. Woo! Oh, I feel such power in this place. Woo! Now, let's look at something else. We're still in the New Testament. Now, let's look at something interesting here. When I saw this, I could not get away from it. Mary, the mother of Jesus, came to Elizabeth, and Elizabeth was her cousin. Elizabeth's husband was Zechariah, the high priest. And Mary and Elizabeth came together. And look at such a powerful anointing that was on Elizabeth. Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste into a city of Judah and entered into the house of Zacharias and saluted Elizabeth. And it came to pass when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe leaped in her womb and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. She spake out with a loud voice and she said, blessed art thou among women and blessed is the fruit of thy womb. Whence is this to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For lo, as soon as the voice of your salutation sounded in my ears, the baby jumped in my womb for joy. And blessed is she that believed, for there shall be a performance of those things which were told her from the Lord. Now I want you to look at Mary. This is the mother of Jesus. Look at what she says and what she prophesies. Mary cries out in the Magnificat, my soul does magnify the Lord. My soul does magnify the Lord. And my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior. He has regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. For he that is mighty has done great things, and holy is his name. And look what Mary says about her son. His mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. Oh my God, I feel that. His mercy is on generation after generation after generation. It's on this generation. Also, it's in Arizona. It's at Fresh Start Church. Woo! Mercy! Say it out loud. Mercy! Look what else she said. And she said, he showed strength with his arm, and he scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He's helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy. Verse 58, her neighbors and her cousin heard how the Lord had showed great mercy upon her, and they rejoiced with her to perform the mercy promised to our fathers and remember his holy covenant. Through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high has visited us. So what Mary was singing about is she's saying, the baby in my womb is a baby that's going to show mercy from generation to generation. Yes, he's all powerful, and yes, he has all power, he has all might, but you will touch him and move him by appealing to his mercy. Then I looked at Hebrews. I went back to the Old Testament. I'm going to read from the New Testament, but I went back to the Old Testament. Moses came before the Lord, and Moses said to the Lord, he said, Lord, I don't want to go. I won't go unless your presence goes with us. And God said, okay. He said, my presence will go. So when they left Egypt and they got out in the wilderness, they had spoiled the Egyptians, so they had their silver and their gold and their precious stones. When they got out there in the wilderness, God spoke to the apostle Moses. He was the first apostle. God spoke to the apostle Moses, and he gave him the outline for the first church. And he said, there'll be an outer court where the sacrifices will be offered. It'll be a public place where everybody can come. There'll be an inner court where there'll be a lampstand and shoe bread, which represents the soul. There'll be an innermost court, a holy place, most holy place. And he said, there'll be a piece of furniture in there called the Ark of the Covenant. There'll be a cherubim on this end with his wings facing this way. There'll be another cherubim on this end facing with their wings this way. And he said, in the middle, there'll be a seat called mercy. There'll be a seat called mercy. What Moses asked the Lord was this. He said, Lord, I ain't gonna go unless your presence goes. And God said, my presence will go. But the place where I will dwell, let it be known to all the children of Israel that the mercy and the presence will always go together. Let me tell you what I learned. I preach this at my church, at Church of His Presence. When I preached it, it really turned out good. The people got a hold of it. They rejoiced. We had a great service. I preached on it two or three times. I can't remember. It wasn't until I was in Arkansas, and I was preaching in Arkansas, preaching on mercy. And when I got to this point of the message, I had the Holy Spirit talk to me while I was preaching to those people in Arkansas, and here's what the Lord said. He said, son, at the Brownsville Revival, what was the song that was sung every night in revival? And the song was Mercy Seat. I remember when revival first broke out, we hadn't been going probably a week. Min Lindell was in the back talking, and was back there with Steve. And a guy knocked on the door and he said, "Brother Kilpatrick, I don't want to bother you." He said, "But you know," he said, "I just want to tell you," he said, "I don't ever do this, but," he said, "there's a girl here." He said, "She's a young girl." And he said, "That girl can really sing." But he said, "I want you to hear her yourself." And I looked at Lyndall, he looked at me, and we almost didn't go because we get those kind of requests a lot, you know. "I want you to hear this people sing and all that." We almost didn't go. But I felt a nudge. Go listen to her. Got back there, and she was, I think, 15 years old, wasn't she? About 15. Had zits all over her face. Had long hair down to here. Sort of looked like a little Mennonite girl. Sort of had that look about her. Nothing wrong with that, but she just looked really pure and really holy. Just zits all over her little face. She's 15 years old. We walked in. She's real shy. And we walked in, and Lyndall sort of intimidated her because she knew who Lyndall was, and he was a great worship leader. And he said, "Well, honey, let's see what you do. Let's hear what you've got." With no music, she stood up, opened up her mouth, and she started singing "Mercy Seat." When she started singing "Mercy Seat," it hit me like a mule kicked me in the belly. I looked at Lyndall, he looked at me like, "Oh my God." So every night of the revival, and she was there every night, and if she couldn't be there, which was rare, Lyndall would sing it every single night of the revival. That revival went for 5 years. 4.5 million people came through those doors at Brownsville. And every night, the song that was always sung at the altar call was "Mercy Seat." And when she would belt that song out, the sinners would come running. You could not resist it. They'd come running. People would stand there. I'd see them stand there and grip the back of the pews until their knuckles would turn white. Big burly men. And when she would sing that about the mercy of God, and Steve would call out, "Come on, friend, come on, come now, hurry, hurry." Sometimes they couldn't even have the strength to make it to the altar. They'd just fall and collapse in between the pews. And our ushers were trained to go down and get them and drag them the rest of the way. Amen. In other words, bless God, we're going to get your hide to that altar. Amen. One way or the other, we're going to get your hide to the altar. And I've seen them pick up big old burly country men, weighed 300 pounds, big old strong burly men, guys that worked as lumberjacks, and I've seen millionaires there and billionaires. And they would just collapse when she would sing that song under the presence of God and under the power of conviction as Steve would give that altar call. And the ushers would go in there and get them out from in between the pews, would move the seats out, and they'd bring them in. And they'd bring them to the altar. And I had the Holy Spirit ask me this question. He said, "Son, do you know why that revival lasted so long? Do you know why my presence was there every night? It wasn't the preaching. It wasn't the worship. It wasn't Pensacola. It wasn't Brownsville. It was the song 'Mercy Seat' was sung every night. And my presence and the mercy of God was there every single night." Come on, give God praise. God said this. He said, "I want you to build me a place." And he said, "Yes, I'll go with you." But he said, "My presence." When the high priest would take the hyssop and the blood of bulls and goats and sprinkle it on the mercy seat, the Shekinah glory of God would erupt. Today, if there's a need that I see in the church world, I don't see the need for many things that many pastors probably and many church leaders think that they've got to have. Coming from my perspective, as somebody that's been in revival, that doesn't make me an expert, and I'm not saying this in an arrogant way. Don't take me wrong. But the thing that I think is missing in our churches is the presence of God. The presence of God. When the mercy is proclaimed, and when the mercy is lifted up, not faith, and faith is important. The Bible says it's impossible to please God without faith. It's impossible to please God. But I've come to a different, completely different revelation. And it takes the onus off of us. It takes the onus off of us, like, God, look at me. I want to show you I've got great faith. And he says, yeah, sure, okay, show me. And faith is important. But God said, all the way through the Old Testament and all the way through that New Testament, and I'm showing it to you, I'm not through just quite yet. But he said, son, appeal to my mercy. So you know what? Now, when I have a situation come up in my life, it takes a lot of the praying. It eliminates a lot of the praying. Let me show you something. Let me just tell you something real quick. I saw something not long ago. I was preaching on blessings. I've been preaching on blessings for years. Matter of fact, what I was known for before revival was I was preaching on mystery and power of a blessing. Preached on it a lot. I've traveled the country preaching on blessings back then. So here a while back, I was preaching on blessings, and I was talking about curses and blessings. And I went back over there in the Old Testament. I went to Genesis, and I was looking, and I saw about Adam and Eve whenever they sinned. And when they sinned, the earth was cursed. Adam and Eve was cursed. The animal creation was cursed. A curse fell on everything. And the Lord said to Adam and Eve, he said, okay, now, he said, you're going to have to earn your living by the sweat of your brow because of the curse. Y'all listening to me? You got to earn your living because of the curse. You got to earn it by the sweat of your brow. In other words, it's going to be laborious. So, I went over there and I saw when Jesus came, the Bible said, cursed is everyone that hangeth upon a tree. So when Jesus died, the Bible said his visage was twisted to where he didn't even look like a man. The man on the middle cross is such a champion that he took on the dogs of the damned. You read about it in the book of Psalms. The hellions, the dogs of the damned, bull demons, man in the cross, on the middle cross. And the Bible said that darkness came at midday. I don't think that the darkness was because of an eclipse. I believe the darkness was because hell was emptying out all the powers and principalities and rulers of darkness that it could muster up. And Jesus took the curse for us that we might not have to suffer the curse. So, I saw something. Jesus was speaking on the water. He's speaking at the edge of the water, and had thousands of people gathered there. And Jesus knew that he didn't have a microphone, and he knew that he needed to get out in a boat and launch out a little bit from the crowd, and that water would carry his voice. It would amplify his voice, and that water would carry his voice. All those people on the shore could hear him. So he just stepped over in a boat, and it happened to be Simon Peter's boat. And he said, may I borrow your boat? And Simon said, well, sure. So Jesus sat there in the boat, and he spoke and he preached to everybody on the seashore. And when he got through, he turned to Simon and he said, go on out a little bit further out here for a draught of fish. Draught of fish. And so Peter said, okay. So they got on out there a little bit. And the Lord said, drop your net now for a big catch of fish. And Peter said, Lord, he said, now, you know, we fish these waters all the time, and we just recently fished here. The temperature is not right. The fish are not here. He said, but nevertheless, it's your word, we'll do it. They dropped the nets. And here's the thing that I want to say to you is, if you have something that the Lord needs, and you lend it to him, he won't just pay you back. He will more than pay you back. So watch this. He said, launch on out, and they let down their nets, and all of a sudden the boat began to sink. There was such a weight of all the fish that they were catching. The net break. They called out to their friends, night. Their partners, come over here, help us, hurry. And here's what I want to point out to you, though. This is the important point. You remember what Peter said to the Lord? He said, Lord, there's no need to drop the net here. We've toiled all night last night, and there's no need to let down our net. Here's what I want to say to you. When Jesus died on Calvary, and when he came, he had no curse on him in the first place. And whenever he came, what he was actually saying was this. Because there is no curse, and because I'm going to die on Calvary and I'm going to take the curse, what Jesus said is, when the curse leaves, the toil leaves also. Listen to this. Stay with me for a minute. Stay with me for a minute. So, when Peter saw that, and he saw all the fish, if you read it in your Bible, in King James Version, it said he knelt down at Jesus' knees. And here's what he said. He said, Lord, oh my God, I'm a sinful man. I'm such a sinful man. In other words, what he was saying is, you took the toil out of so easy. And I said, we've toiled all night, caught nothing. I had no confidence we was going to catch anything. I was depending on the weather. I was depending on the location of the fish. I was depending on the moon and all those things. But at your word, it was so effortless. He used the word toil. When Jesus died on Calvary, no longer do you have to earn the money that you get by the sweat of your brow. There's plenty of people that earns money without sweating of the brow, without working in farming and other things. We all have to work, and we all have to be diligent, but he takes the toil out of it. Now, let me share something else with you. Not only did he take the toil out of work, but he took the toil out of praying. Yes, we must intercede. And yes, God will saddle us with burdens to pray about. But he said, come unto me. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. I'm taking the toil out of it for you. It's going to be a joy serving me. It's going to be good. You're going to love serving me. I am your friend. I am your God. I am full of mercy. Come on, give God praise. Woo! Let me close. I'm not through, but let me close. Oh, I got a lot of time left. Let me close this thing down. So one of the things that the Holy Spirit was showing me is it's not about sweat anymore. It's about mercy. There's something about we Christians, we feel like we got to earn it. Got to earn it. Got to earn it. I remember I was praying at Brownsville one night before revival broke out. And I said, Lord, I said, I'm so hungry for you. I remember I'd wake up some mornings at home about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. I'd wake up and I'd have such an insatiable hunger in my heart. I'd burning on the inside for the Lord. I wasn't burning for a sermon. I wasn't burning for a song. I didn't want to hear worship. I was burning for him. I remember one night my wife and I went to New Orleans. We had a nice evening over there. We ate out and we came home. Went to bed about 4 o'clock in the morning. I remember I woke up. And when I woke up, I was just burning and tears was running down my face, hot tears. It's like I woke up and it's like I gotta have you. Oh God, I can't live without you. I gotta have you. I'd get up many mornings. I'd just put on a pair of sweatpants, t-shirt, wouldn't even put on shoes. I'd drive across town, Pensacola, and I'd go in through the breezeway at Brownsville, let myself in the back door. And many times in the dark, and they would put the lights on, many times there's a front bench here, and I just fall up against that bench, and I grab hold of the end of the bench, and I just begin to moan and bellow like a cow. just noise coming out of me. It wasn't words, it wasn't articulation. It was moaning and groaning, and I'd do that sometime in the wee hours of the morning. It was like 4 o'clock in the morning. I'd hear these sounds coming out of me, and I'd say, God, what is going on? And I'd just be moaning and bellering. And it would scare me sometime to hear the sounds coming out of me. And I'd wake up 2 or 3 days later, and the same thing would get on me. I'd go to Brownsville, and I'd hit that pew and grab the end of it and just beller. Couldn't even articulate any words. Wasn't speaking in tongues. Just moaning and groaning. One night I was down at Brownsville praying, and I was really in the throes of that thing where God was all over me. And it was quiet. I was in the church. All the lights were out, and I was quiet. And I had the Holy Spirit come up beside me, and I heard the Lord say to me just as plain as he could speak, may I borrow this church? And I said, Lord, it's not my church. This is your church. I said, I'm the under shepherd. You're the chief shepherd. I said, Lord, do whatever you want to do. He said, may I borrow this church? And you know what he said? I'll pay my own way. He said, I'll pay my own way, Pastor. I believe that's a word for you. He said, I'll pay my own way. Let me tell you what happened. I had just moved out of the, we just moved the sanctuary not too long before that. And after we moved out of the other building across the street, which we call the chapel, I was remodeling in it. We didn't have the money, and I had borrowed $300,000 and didn't know how in the world I was going to pay it back. But I didn't want people bringing their kids into that building and it looking so bad. It needed new electrical, it needed new receptacles, it needed new sheetrock. It was just a mess. And so I don't like that. So I wanted everybody to bring their family into a nice building. And my board was on my case, and they said, Pastor, you need to raise some money this coming Sunday. And I said, I know, I'll do that. But I'm the worst at raising money. I hate to do it. I'd rather somebody whip me with a switch and have to raise money. And so that morning they said, Pastor, you're going to have to raise money? I said, okay, when I get through preaching, I will. So I didn't do it. So I was in a place of business. and it was before the days of cell phones. And I was sitting in this place of business in Pensacola, and my treasurer called me. And whenever he found me in this place of business, I thought, oh my God, this is serious. Because the man said behind the desk, he said, it's for you. And I thought, oh Lord, what has happened? So I answered the phone, and he said, Pastor, you sitting down? I thought, oh God, yes I am. He said, listen, we just counted the money from last night. This was Thursday. It was Wednesday night. He said, we just counted the money from last night, Wednesday. And he said, there's a check in there for $50,000. And I said, So I said to myself, I'll go by, when I leave here, I'll go by the church, pick up a copy of the check, and I'll call and see how high it's going to bounce. So I went that night, had supper at home. I went in my office at home, called this guy, and I said, this is Pastor Kilpatrick. And I said, I want you to know that my office called me and told me that you gave a generous offering to the church, and I just wanted to call you and tell you, I don't recognize your name, but I sure thank you for blessing the church. It was very much needed. He said, oh, thank you, Pastor. He said, I'm a businessman. I own an industry in Pensacola. I said, oh, okay. He said, I've been watching you on television, WPMI out of Mobile, and he said, I've been watching your series on mental tar babies. And I was preaching a series on mental tar babies, how things stick, you know, in your mind. And he said, my wife died 5 years ago, and he said, when she died, I have 2 daughters that lives on the West Coast. I don't have any other family here. And he said, whenever my wife died, I was given over to a sin. I got trapped in a sin, and it grabbed hold of me, and he said, it was a vicious sin. And he said, I tried my best to get free of it. I couldn't get free of it. And he said, I was going to leave on Friday and disappear and never be heard from again. I was going to disappear into anonymity. And he said, I cut the TV on that night, and at 11 o'clock you came on WPMI. And he said, you said you're going to be preaching a series entitled Mental Tar Babies. And he said, I watched part one and it helped me so much. He said, I said, well, I'll cancel this and I'll wait a week because I want to hear part two. Well, bless God, I don't just preach series, friends. I preach 10-part series. Amen. So You know, don't fool around. If you're going to preach a series, preach a series, you know. Don't preach these little mini-series, praise God. Preach a series. So I preached 10 parts, and he said, I listened to every one of them. He said, you preached 10 parts. I said, yeah. He said, after you got through preaching the 10th part, he said, with nobody praying for me or laying a hand on me, he said, God completely broke that thing and set me free. So he said, that's where I gave that offering last night. So the next week, I'm somewhere, my treasurer calls me, Pastor, you sitting down? I said, yeah. He said, whoo! He said, there's a check in the offering for $125,000. I said, hi. He called me the next week, Pastor, you sitting down? I said, yeah. He said, there's a check in there for $340,000. I said, whoa. So he called me the next week. He said, Pastor, you sitting down? Yeah. He said, there's a check in there for, $450,000. By the time that man got through giving, he gave well over $1 million to the church. He said it was back tithes from where he robbed God for about 5 years. The Lord said, ha! Listen, here's what he said. The Lord came to me and he said, may I borrow this church? Like he said to Peter, may I borrow your boat? If the Lord needs to borrow something from you, let him have it. He'll more than pay his way. Let me tell you what happened. You can be seated. Let me tell you what happened. When revival broke out, I had to move all those houses around Brownsville. People lived in them. I went and I had my board go bargain with them for a price. I paid them more than what their house was worth. I relocated them, got them in a house, paid their utilities, cut their utilities on, bought up all those houses, demolished them, expanded the parking lot. I bought up all the technology that we were going to need when revival broke out. When revival broke out, I had closed circuit television, I had parking, I had everything that I needed, and as soon as revival broke out, that man never gave another dime. God said, may I borrow this church? I'll pay my way. Friend, if God needs something, let him have it. And here's what I'm trying to say. The Lord took the toil out of it. Can I give this word to somebody? Stop worrying. Can I say it again? Stop worrying. If you're sick and the doctor says you won't recover, stop worrying. He's taken the toil out of it. Be healed in the name of Jesus by the mercy of God. Let me close. Okay. The dedication of Solomon's temple. It came to pass as the trumpeters and singers were as one to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. When they lifted up their voice with trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music, they praised the Lord. And look what they sang. Only one stanza. Only one chant. The Lord is good. And his mercy endureth forever. It didn't have any verses. It didn't have any choruses. All the singers and the music came to a crescendo in the house of God. And they sang, the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. Look what happened. Then the house was filled with a cloud. Even the house of the Lord, so that the priest could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, and the glory filled the house of God. So what happened at Brownsville? Every night, mercy, come run in mercy seat. And the presence of God was in that church for 5 years. Such a presence that now I look back at it and I wonder, just suppose after the first 3 months we got tired of that song and we said to Charity, sing a different song, sweetheart, we're tired of that one. I believe the revival would have come to screeching halt. But he wanted his mercy to be heralded every night to people all over the world. And his mercy endures forever. I'm not through, but I'm going to quit. I feel like that the Holy Spirit is really speaking to some of you. And what He's speaking is not so much grace. And I love grace. Don't get me wrong, I love it. And I love faith. But I've had a revelation of God's mercy, and I just can't get over it. Mercy. Mercy. There's times when I get a bad report in the middle of the night. Somebody calls and there's an emergency. First words out of my mouth now, this has become such a part of me, I say, mercy, Lord, mercy, mercy. I appealed to His mercy. I don't know what you're going through today. It may be a vicious report. It may have rocked your world. It may be a divorce. You may have had divorce papers served on you. It may be that you've been caught in sin and your world is crumbling around you. It could be that your child has been diagnosed. And that man said this. He said, Jesus, have mercy on my boy. He said, I've seen the Spirit take him and throw him in the fire. And he said, I've seen the Spirit take him and put him underwater before I could get to him, and I thought for sure he's going to drown. He said, Lord, if you can do anything, have mercy on him. Jesus cast the devil out of him because the Father appealed to the Lord's mercy. But the man said something I want to leave with you. He said something that I have spoke on and I have talked about for years, but I really had a revelation of it. Here's what he said. He said, Lord, he said, if you can do anything, Lord, he said, help me, have mercy on me. And so Jesus said this to him. He said, if you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. And here's what the man said, and I love this about him. He said, Lord, I believe. But he said, help my unbelief. Now, I want to just leave you with this, and I promise I'll close. Here's what he said. He said something that few of us would dare to venture into. See, a lot of times we try to impress God. A lot of times we try to impress one another. When I first started pastoring, I learned more about myself than I did about the ministry. When I started preaching every week, there's people that have been brought up in churches to believe that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is not real. There's people that's been brought up in churches to believe that divine healing and miracles is not for today. There's people that's been brought up to believe that the apostolic and the prophetic is not for today. And you've been brought up and you've had credible teachers and preachers and parents maybe even drill you and tell you that it's not real, it's fake, don't believe it, it's bad doctrine. One of the things I began to learn whenever I started pastoring was there's some things I'd take and I'd preach it, man, and I could make it ring. I'd had a ping to it. I could make it ring. And then I'd venture into other things in the scriptures and I got excited about it and I'd preach it, but it didn't have the ping. It didn't have that convincibility about it. And even when I was preaching it, it was sort of falling short. And I began to realize I had areas in my life of unbelief. I began to realize as a preacher, Pentecostal preacher, Assemblies of God preacher, I had areas of unbelief. And I didn't know it till I started preaching. And when I would try to make something ring, I couldn't do it. And here's what I began to do. I heard a black preacher preaching years ago, and he was a singer also. And he made a statement one time in a song, and then he made a statement one time in a sermon. And I, in the 70s, I took that to my tape department at my church, and I asked them to take that portion out of his song and a portion of his message and to just put it on a tape by itself and play it where it would loop and play over and over and over. And so when I'd be traveling along during the daytime, I'd put that tape in, and the area where I was having unbelief, and the area where I was struggling, he would preach that over and over and over and over and over and over. And it was like, and every time I'd hear it, it'd be like a jackhammer hitting concrete. Boom! 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 Until one day, I was riding and I heard it playing, and the concrete broke. And it came through, and revelation came in my life. And when the revelation comes, restoration comes. Listen. Many times, the reason people can't get restoration is because they hadn't had revelation. Revelation brings restoration. And so, what this man said was, he said, "Lord, I believe." In other words, what he was saying is, "Lord, I'm a believer. I'm a believer. I'm here. I got my boy here. I'm a believer." But he said, "I've seen the devil throw him in the fire, and it traumatized me. I've seen the devil put him underwater, and if I hadn't got him out, he'd have drowned. It's traumatized me, Lord. I know you can do it, but I've seen so much. I'm struggling with unbelief." And here's what I want to say to you in closing this morning. If you have unbelief, it doesn't matter. Just appeal to the mercy of God, and He'll have mercy on you in spite of your unbelief. You have enough belief in you that you can get a miracle. Come on, give God praise. Hey! Woo! Hey! Shaban riba ramo satamba. I want everybody to stand with me just for a moment. I want to pray with you before I leave. I want to say a prayer for you. I want to speak a prayer over you. And here's what I want to pray. I want to pray for mercy. I don't know what you're going through, and only God knows. When I go into places like this, and I don't know anybody, I have no idea what you're going through, what you've heard, or what you've experienced, or how you've been traumatized, what kind of reports you've got, what you're suffering with right now. And as you're sitting here listening to me preach, you feel rays of light and rays of hope beginning to come into your spirit. Because you're saying, "Lord, boy, if it depended on my faith right now, I just don't know that I've got the level of faith I need to have. But oh God, I appeal to your mercy." Let's pray together. Pray this out loud with me like you really mean it. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Come on, everybody. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
I come before you. Lord, you know me.
Lord, you know me.
You know that I love you.
You know that
I'm in the house of God. I wouldn't be here if I didn't believe. But Lord, I'm struggling. I need mercy. Come on, I need mercy. I ask you, Lord Jesus, Son of David, on me. Help me, Lord. I appeal to your mercy for my son. I appeal to your mercy for my daughter. I appeal to your mercy for my friend, for my relative, for my co-worker, for my neighbor. I appeal to you, Lord, and I ask you, show mercy. I believe today as I leave this place, there's going to be a change. Say it out loud with me. There's going to be a change. I receive it. I believe it. In Jesus' mighty name. Everybody says, amen.
Wow. I don't know if I'll ever be the same. Obviously, God is speaking to Fresh Start Church. The word that Landon brought last night on mercy revealed. The word that Pastor John has released to us this morning. Wow. I think the Holy Spirit, to what he's saying to us and what he's going to say to us in the coming days, I think the Holy Spirit is wanting to give Fresh Start Church a new mentality to embrace a new manifestation of God. You can't wrap your old mind around what God wants to do. And Pastor John just prayed an amazing prayer, but I want to release a prayer over you this morning. So I want you to lift your hands. First of all, Lord, thank you for the revelation that's being released into this house this weekend. And I'm asking you, Father, to let this be more than another great truth that we hear. But this will so go deep within us that it will rearrange the way we think about your mercy. And so, Lord, I ask you now to let this word be impressed in our spirit. Let it shift and literally change our spiritual DNA. That the God of all mercies will be manifested in this house, manifested through your people, manifested to a city and a region. Lord, I pray this morning, as we have sat under your word, that faith has risen and that your mercy is being released. And that as we stand here in your presence, miracles of healing are manifesting. Miracles of provision are manifesting. Restoration of marriages and relationships are manifesting. I thank you this morning, Father, that we will never be the same. We will never worship the same. We will never praise the same. We will never pray the same. We will never read your word the same. That every time we sit in your presence, it's not going to be the same, oh Lord, because you have manifested mercy over this house. You have manifested mercy over our hearts, over our minds, over our families. Lord, we thank you that this place is full of mercy. I thank you for it, Father. And Lord, I bless your people. I bless them with fullness. I bless them with healing. I bless them with health. I bless them with joy and peace. I say I bless you with strength in your inner man. I bless you today with an experience with God that is so real and so genuine. Not just here, but everywhere you go. I bless you today. And may the God of all mercies go with you and overshadow you. And the church said, amen. Come on, put your hands together in this place. Somebody ought to give him one more shout.